Good evening, folks. Karen Sharp here, with Professor Randolph Hemmings. Today the professor will discuss the US Black-White net worth gap.
Thank you, Karen. Net worth is the difference between your assets and liabilities. If you sold everything that you own, and used the proceeds to pay off all your debts, how much money would you have left over? It measures a family's financial success. Median net worth for everyone rises and falls with the nation's economic situation. To focus on racial differences, we compare the median black family's net worth to that of the median white family, rather than the absolute value of either. In 1970, at the end of the civil rights movement, the median black family's net worth was 1/4 that of the white family. By 1980, the ratio had fallen to 15%. By 1990, it had fallen to 12%, by 2004 to 9%, and the latest measure, 2007, is at 6%. Black net worth has been falling for the past half century. The plunge is accelerating. The measurements have been confirmed and reconfirmed. They form the basis for everything that I'm about to say, as we seek explanations for the catastrophe. Income difference does not explain the crash. Although a difference between median black and white family income exists, it is 1/10 the net worth difference. The ratio of black to white income, the upper line, has ranged between 60 and 80% during the same period, that the ratio of black to white net worth, the lower line, fell from 25 to 6%. Another way of seeing this is to compare white families making under $30,000 per year with black families making over $50,000 per year. High-income black families save virtually nothing compared to middle-income white families. Indeed, they save no more than do middle-income black families. Parental wealth also fails to explain the crash. Consider generational class mobility. The American dream is that children grow up with more opportunities and greater financial success than their parents. If half of children wind up better off than their parents, and half worse off, there would be no generational mobility. Positive mobility means that more than half of children achieve more than their parents. Negative means that most wind up poorer than their parents. The two left columns show families in poverty. The two right columns show middle-income families. The two front columns, in blue, show black families. The two rear columns, in red, show white families. The right rear column shows that over 2/3 of middle-class white children gain more wealth than their parents. Fewer than 1/3 descend the economic ladder. This shows positive class mobility. The right front column shows that the numbers are reversed for black children. Fewer than 1/3 of middle-class black children gain more wealth than their parents, over 2/3 descend the economic ladder. The numbers are similar for families in poverty. The left rear column shows that 2/3 of poor white children escape poverty in one generation. The left front column shows that most black children born into poverty stay in poverty. And so, black family net worth falls with each passing generation. This is the same information of the first graph. It is just depicted differently. Another way of seeing the difference is that black and white families put the same fraction of money into home ownership. But few black families put cash into savings accounts, money market accounts, certificates of deposit, bonds, or stocks. Black families use their money to cover expenses instead of accumulating savings. The accelerating collapse was not always the case. We can estimate net worth ratio in the early colonial period by comparing what fraction of African Americans owned land and slaves to the fraction of European Americans who owned land and slaves. Estimated thus, the black-white net worth ratio was 61% in 1660. African American net worth then fell for the next two centuries, as the slave system took hold, bottoming out at about 4% in 1860. After slavery ended, black families' net worth rose steadily. The improvement continued throughout the Jim Crow era of state-sponsored terrorism against African Americans. Today's plunge began shortly after the Jim Crow era ended. The past four decades have witnessed the economic collapse of African American families to poverty levels of the Jim Crow era and before. The proximate cause is trivial. For any given level of income, the typical African American family spends more and saves less than the corresponding white family. That is how net worth is computed after all. The deeper cause is not obvious. What is behind the discrepancy between the relatively small difference in income and the catastrophic fall in net worth? The two most popular hypotheses for the discrepancy are white racism or black extravagance. I shall discuss those at the very end of my presentation. Seven other popular hypotheses are: no generational nest egg, depreciating homes, single-parent households, worsening overall inequality, poor relatives, higher interest rates, and oppositional culture. Let us examine these one by one. According to the nest egg hypothesis, Jim Crow-era repression, especially redlining after World War II, barred African-American families from collecting the capital that others passed down from one generation to the next, either in the form of college tuition or home mortgage down payments. Consequently, black families have less college education, less home equity, and pay more in loan interest. Unable to accumulate capital, they have no nest egg to pass on to their children, and so the cycle continues. The nest egg hypothesis has been disproved. At most, it explains 10 to 20% of the black-white net worth gap, mainly in the form of higher interest rates. The remaining 80 to 90% of the gap remains to be explained. Also, the hypothesis predicts that black children of wealthy parents would be more successful than those with poor parents. But as shown earlier, the reverse is the case. Black children born into poverty are more likely to succeed than those from middle-class families. Homes depreciate. Most household capital is in home equity, which grows as real estate values increase. This hypothesis says that black neighborhood deterioration makes homes fall in value, so black household capital evaporates. The depreciating homes hypothesis has been disproved. There is no racial difference in the likelihood that homes will depreciate. According to Gittleman and Wolf, blacks actually earned a higher rate of return on capital than did whites from 1984 to 1994. 41% compared with 32%. Home prices increased faster for blacks than for whites. This may seem counterintuitive. As reported by Hacker, Keating, and others, real estate often loses value when white neighborhoods become black neighborhoods. But the losers in such cases are the former white owners who bought high and sold low, not the new black owners who bought low and have not sold. Single-parent households. Single-parent households are less profitable than two-parent households, even when only one parent works outside the home. This hypothesis says that the net worth gap is because more black than non-black households are headed by single parents. This hypothesis has been disproved. The net worth gap is unchanged after correcting for the prevalence of single-parent households. Overall U.S. inequality. Over the past half century, U.S. society has become increasingly unequal. A shrinking fraction of the populace holds a growing lion's share of the wealth. At the end of World War II, the richest 10% of the population earned 35% of the income. By 2007, the same 10% earned 50% of the national income. The rich have become richer and fewer, the middle class has become poorer, and the poor have become more numerous. This hypothesis says that, since African American families were already poorer four decades ago, worsening overall inequality impacted them more. The inequality hypothesis has been disproved. An earlier chart showed a widening gap between high-income and middle-income white families. This is predicted by worsening inequality. But it also showed a narrowing gap between high-income and middle-income black families. This contradicts the hypothesis of widening inequality causing the black-white gap. Let me clarify. I'm not saying that worsening inequality does not strike black families disproportionately. It clearly does. At the start of the current period of worsening inequality, African Americans were at the bottom of the economic ladder. They are still at the bottom, but the top has moved out of reach. What I'm saying is that worsening inequality cannot be the cause of the plunge in black net worth. If it were the cause, we would see a widening of the rich-poor gap among African Americans. Poor relatives. Black families, even successful ones, have more impoverished relatives than do non-black families. This hypothesis says that much black spending is for financial assistance to less fortunate members of the extended family, an expense that is rare among non-blacks. This hypothesis has not been tested. Higher interest rates. Black families pay higher interest rates than do white families for the same loans. This hypothesis has been confirmed. But this explains only about 10% of the discrepancy. In addition, this is a proximate cause, not a deeper cause. Higher interest rates seem to be driven by higher lender risk. Black families are nearly twice as likely as whites to default on home loans. Also, the higher black foreclosures rate is not due to lower income. Loan default is more common among high-income black families than among lower-income. Oppositional culture. Many have shown that an oppositional culture arises among black adolescents. It lasts at least through high school. It takes the form of peer attacks on children who get good grades. Attackers accuse good students of acting white, selling out, or betraying their race by being Toms or Aureus. Consequently, there is a consistent and replicable black-white test score gap in the United States. This has inspired two hypotheses regarding net worth. First, is the possibility that a similar culture exists among black adults who see financial success itself as a form of selling out. Second, is that oppositional culture dissuades children from learning basic money management skills, just as it dissuades them from learning math, science, or literature. Consequently, this hypothesis says that a large fraction of black adults do not know how to live within their means. Neither of these hypotheses has been tested. In conclusion, recent findings about the US black-white net worth gap are, it has been worsening for 4 decades. It is not related to income, lack of generational nest egg, overall inequality, depreciating homes, or single families. It is related to higher interest rates. It may possibly be related to supporting poor relatives, or to some aspect of oppositional culture. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Professor. You said you would come back to white racism or black extravagance as possible causes, but you never did.
Sorry, I forgot. I wanted to say that no one has proposed a way of measuring either white racism or black extravagance. Until someone comes up with a way of measuring those factors, they are not valid hypotheses at all. Personally, I use intermarriage rate as the measure of white acceptance, so you might say it measures absence of racism. But intermarriage has climbed steadily over the same period that black net worth has plummeted.
I see what you mean. Rising intermarriage suggests that lack of white acceptance is not the cause. About those interest rates. High interest rates penalize responsible blacks by lumping them with defaulters, while irresponsible whites benefit by being grouped together with reliable whites. Is that fair?
Fair? I suppose not, but it is the way business works.
I see. Well, that is our time for today, ladies and gentlemen. This is Karen Sharp.
And Randolph Hemmings.
Signing off until next time.